Data can often be represented as graphs, with nodes representing the training samples and edges representing some similarity measure. In many cases, however, you would like to have vectors rather than nodes of a graph, because there's a lot of machinery that you can use in a vector space. So it's of interest to know how to turn a graph into a vector, a set of vectors that maintain much of the similarity structure and neighborhood relationships of the graph. And this is where spectral graph theory can be used. In particular, we're considering the Laplacian matrix, which can be used on the one hand for an embedding of nodes in a vector space and also for clustering. So first I want to talk about an intuition that helps maybe understanding how the Laplacian matrix works, and that's the intuition of the heat diffusion. So here we see an example of a graph that's drawn somewhere in space here. And the space is not really relevant. If it's a graph, what's of relevance are the edges between the nodes, and you see here that this forms a linear graph. I have on purpose shuffled the positions in a way that it's not obvious that this is a linear graph. Very often the similarity is actually defined through spatial proximity, so nearby nodes are connected with each other. That is not the case here, so that's somewhat unusual, but for didactic purposes I've chosen it that way. Now, the heat diffusion analogy states that, or makes the following assumption. So you assume that the nodes are heat reservoirs, which are connected by some tubes, so that heat can diffuse between the heat reservoirs. And if there's some heat here, it will diffuse to this node and also to the other node. If there's some heat here, it will diffuse to that reservoir. And if these two reservoirs have the same temperature, there's as much heat going in the one direction than in the other direction. And therefore, there's no further net exchange of heat. Now assume you initialize the heat reservoirs with different amounts of heat, so white being very hot and black very cold, let's say. So this is the initial distribution of heats. Now if you wait and let the heat diffuse along the tubes, the heat of neighboring nodes will balance out. Now, if you wait long enough, all the local fluctuations will disappear and there will be a smooth gradient from one end to the other end. So that's shown here. So this is the highest heat here and then it's going down this line, so the color becomes darker and darker. Now, so the difference, the scaling of the differences is usually much lower here than on that side. So I've amplified that in order to show the distribution of the heat. And now the trick of the Laplacian eigenmap is that you order the nodes along a 1D dimension according to the heat, right? C is the coolest one, so it goes very left. Then comes E, G, B, D, F, A. So you just put them here on the one-dimensional axis according to their temperature. And that leads to a very nice one-dimensional arrangement of the nodes that reflects the structure of the graph. Yeah, so this is sort of a much more appropriate visualization of these nodes if the only thing that matters is the graph structure, not the position of the nodes. Yeah, so that's the trick of the Laplacian eigenmap algorithm. You can intuitively understand it as distributing randomly heat across the graph, then let the heat diffuse for a long time until you have sort of extreme temperatures at the ends and then a smooth gradient across the graph. And that then naturally leads to a very nice embedding of the nodes in a vector space if you position each node according to its temperature. So this is a 1D example. You could also imagine a graph with a more complicated structure, and then you have sort of there's something analog into the other dimension, so you can actually not only do a 1D embedding, you can also do a high dimensional embedding. We get to that later. If you have nodes, or if you have a graph that disconnects into two subsets or three subsets of nodes, like this one here, so FDB is one subgraph, ACEG is one subgraph, you initialize them randomly with temperatures, and then you let the temperatures diffuse. If you wait long enough, all the nodes of one subgraph will assume one temperature, and all the nodes of the other subgraph will assume another temperature. If you now embed the nodes in a 1D vector space according to the temperature, all the nodes that belong to one subgraph sit here at the same position, and all the nodes of the other subgraph sit at another position. And that's convenient if you want to do clustering. So in this case, you just have to set a threshold here that separates the one set of nodes from the other set of nodes. Now, this is a clear-cut situation. Obviously, if you have maybe a weak link here, so it will be not as clear-cut, but still the spectral clustering algorithm, will allow you to embed the nodes in a vector space such that clustering essentially becomes trivial.